Well, good morning, New Song Church. I'm so excited to be worshiping with you guys this morning. I want to invite you all to stand as we kind of enter into this time of worship. And we have a great morning planned, so we're just so excited to be here and worship the Lord together. Amen.
Great is your faithfulness, oh God. Waters and tumors, and nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise.
Amen. Let's give God a round of applause this morning. Heavenly Father, I pray that your Spirit can just enter into this room right now, Father. Lord, let us worship your name as fully as we can. Let's sing this out together.
Remember those walls that we called sin and shame. They were like prisons that we couldn't escape. But he came, and he died, and he rose. Those walls were broken. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring.
Sing it out.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart.
To build our life on you. Help us to trust in the foundation that you can lay at our lives.
I will build my life upon your love. It is a
Heavenly Father, thank you for your glories, for your miracles that you've done in each and every one of our lives. Lord, help us to cherish the blessings that you've lavished upon us, Lord. Help us to see this life, this world, the way that you want us to see it. We're so grateful to serve you, and in Jesus' name, amen.
So this is John, and this is Beth. Come on down, Beth. And we're going to commission them today because, what, a year ago we started our Stephen ministry. These two were trained as Stephen ministers, and the ministry has gotten so large that we need more Stephen ministers. So now they're becoming Stephen minister leaders. Tom and Karen trained the first batch of Stephen ministers, and they're still like our head honchos for the thing, but John and and Beth are stepping up, and these are quality people. Beth not only sings on our worship team and does all kinds of stuff, she's a licensed PA, physician's assistant. This guy used to run the city of Aliso Viejo, so God's using some proven leaders here. Anyway, they're going to lead the next class, which starts when?
February 12th.
February 12th, so that's a Monday. Yeah, and you got like 12 people already?
So far, I think we have 9 for sure.
9?
A couple more.
To do 50 hours of training. Stephen Ministry is kind of a come-alongside friendship ministry for anybody in the church that needs to have a friend who'd want to have a conversation with them once a week, once a month, twice a week, or twice a month, whatever, who might be going through some trauma or something like that, and you guys know all about that, don't you? We have a tradition around here when we commission or dedicate people, we would lay our hands on them. So just pretend you got a go-go gadget arm and put it up here on top of these two. And Father, we commit John and Beth to you as they train this next batch of Stephen ministers to help the rest of us go through some hard or challenging times. Thank you, Lord, that you are the friend who's closer than a brother. I pray that as a result of what they do in training these 9 and potentially more if others step forward, that there'd be a lot of people who feel the hand of Jesus through hands here in this church as a result of our Stephen ministry. We set them apart. We dedicate them to you in Jesus' name. And everybody who agreed said,
amen.
Amen. God bless you. Thank you for what you're doing. Yeah. And now your attention, please, over here.
So we're going to go over here to the baptistry, and we're going to be baptizing Blake Smith today. He is a sergeant in the Marine Corps, and he's responsible for all the booms you hear. Directly responsible. He says fire, and his guys fire, and that's the noise you hear. So he approached me, said, hey, I really want to take the next step of faith and get baptized. And so that's why we're going to baptize him today. His wife is here. Her name is Taylor, and she is pregnant. She has about 1 more month left. So you're technically a dad in our eyes. Your baby's just not out in the world yet. And earlier I asked him, hey, so you want to get baptized? Tell me, what are you going to tell Jesus when you get up to heaven? And he says, hey, why should I let you into my heaven? What are you going to say? You know, that's always my question. He's going to say, well, I don't deserve this. But it's because Jesus died for me that I get to go to heaven. And that's what we're going to be celebrating today, him going down and raising back to life. All that past will be gone, and then you will be a new person. It's a symbol of that. That's already happened when you made that faith, profession of faith. So, Blake, do you believe that Jesus is the Lord and Savior of your life?
Yes.
And is it your intent to follow him for the rest of your life?
Yes, it is.
Then by that profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Hello, and welcome to New Song. I'm Tom Williams, and I serve in the Stephen Ministry here. Sunday morning worship is an absolutely essential part of living a fully devoted Christian life. There are so many commands in Scripture that we just cannot fulfill without the community of God around us. Hopefully, this morning has already been a blessing to you, and you are already feeling filled with the power of the Holy Spirit as we sing. If you are new to New Song this morning, we're so glad you're here. We consider those who are at New Song for the very first time VIPs. We have a team that would love to meet you at the VIP table in the lobby. Would you take the connection card that's in your program out there after the service? If you do, they have a gift for you this morning. It's a book that answers the 5 biggest questions people have about God, and a cool New Song tumbler. If this is not your first time to New Song, would you also please fill out that connection card? We ask everyone to do this so that we can know you were here, so we can be praying for you, and to hear if you had spiritual conversations this past week. You can drop those in the offering bags after the message. And hello to those of you joining us online today as well. Please fill out that digital connection card right now, along with our live congregation. We're so glad you're with us online today. Our program is full of events, groups, and services to help you become a fully devoted follower of Jesus. take a second to look through it to see what might apply to you. While you're doing that, there are a couple of things coming up that we want to highlight.
Willie Buchanan is more than an Oceanside resident. He is what some call a legend of the game. Willie Buchanan was an All-American and rated one of the top cornerback prospects of the decade while at San Diego State. Between his amazing athletic ability and dedication to the game, he was a clear choice for the NFL. Not only did the Green Bay Packers make him their first draft pick in 1972, he exceeded expectations when he became a starter during the preseason and went on to be named the AP Defensive Rookie of the Year. Willie was a perennial All-Pro candidate throughout his career and was selected to the Pro Bowl squad for his great plays in 1973, 1974, and 1978. He holds two NFL records, most interceptions and most fumble recoveries in a game. He played 7 years with the Green Bay Packers and 4 years with the San Diego Chargers. Willie was part of Sporting News all-time college team, San Diego Chargers 50th anniversary team, Green Bay Packers Hall of Fame, Green Bay Packers all-time team, City of Oceanside Hall of Fame, San Diego State Hall of Fame, San Diego Hall of Champions, California State Junior College Hall of Fame, Oceanside High School Hall of Fame. Today, through the Buchanan Youth Foundation, Willie is still advocating for sports and committed to teaching youth the benefits that sports can play in building a strong foundation for life. The Buchanan Youth Foundation is designed to teach youth leadership skills, commitment, and good sportsmanship that will enhance their everyday life through athletics. He's been married for 46 years. He has 2 children and 8 grandchildren.
Before we continue in our service, take a second to meet some of the amazing people around you. God intended us to live the Christian life in community, and we should know the other people that we worship with. So please stand up now and go make some new friends.
If you're ready to do some learning this morning, set the Wayback Machine. Remember that? Set the Wayback Machine for 33 AD and come with me to a few miles north of Jerusalem. It's really kind of this time of year, late winter or perhaps early spring. Jesus and his disciples have been meandering south from Caesarea Philippi, heading to downtown Jerusalem, and they're almost there. Along the way, every day, a new person or two or three or six or ten have joined them, so that now there's a large crowd going with Jesus all the way south. It's kind of the great southward migration. Last Sabbath day, Jesus was invited over after preaching at the local synagogue to a prominent religious leader's home, a Pharisee, who invited all of his friends to lunch, including a friend who had dropsy. If you were here 2 weeks ago, you remember it's the Sabbath day, and they had a question about whether you could heal on the Sabbath, and Jesus clears that one up. He lays hands on the man, says, "Be healed," and everybody gasps as the swelling in this man's face and then his neck and his arms and then his ankles and his feet goes down, and he's healed. He walks away clean. He had a death sentence on him, and now he's going to live a long, long time. Well, these Pharisees who had a perception of Jesus, you know, he's from northern Israel, he's like a rural guy, not a city guy, wondered if this backwoods rabbi had anything to say, if he was worth listening to or worth trusting. I think they're starting to think, well, maybe he is okay. He's gained some street cred with them, so on the way into lunch, he teaches them how to throw a party and how to act at a party. Then he talks about the great party that'll be in heaven, and they're thinking some more of maybe this guy is okay. In last week's message, Pastor Scott talked to us about what Jesus did when he left that house. He talked to the crowd as he's walking with them about commitment, about counting the cost, about loving God so much it seemed like you hated your father and mother and sister and brother by contrast. He talked to them in that talk about possessions, that we ought not love stuff like we love God. Count the cost, he said, count the cost. Loosen your grip on things, stay fresh in your faith, be salt and light to people around you. And the Pharisees listened. Jesus is calling for commitment, and I don't know if you've ever thought about this, but almost every time someone calls for commitment to me, I go to jury on it. Do I want to make that commitment? Should I make that commitment? Can I make that commitment? Well, say what you will about the Pharisees, but they may have been the people who made commitments better than anybody else in history. These are guys who fasted every Monday and every Thursday to strengthen their self-control and to show God that they loved him. So as they're thinking about, do I want to make this cost? Do I want to play on Jesus' team? Jesus enters one more village. It's the village just in front of him. It's a small Middle Eastern village. Like every village at that time, it has a town square, and he heads for that. If I'm picturing it right, it's probably got a fishmonger shop on one side and the government building on the other with the synagogue straight down the center. Can you see it? Jesus enters the square, and he does what he always does when he enters the square. He greets the widows and orphans. There's ladies begging on the street because they have no visible means of deriving income. There's orphans that come up to him, and he gives them a big hug. As this is happening, there's kind of a commotion. You know, he's got a lot of people with him. So the fishmonger comes out of his stall, and the tax collector with all his clerks comes out of his office. The Pharisees are watching. They're wondering about him. And Jesus does something at that moment that loses all their trust. When the tax collector comes out, he says, "Hey, Jesus, would you eat lunch with me today?" And you know what Jesus says? "I will. I will." The Pharisees over here watch him walk to the outdoor restaurant, sit down across the table from the tax collector and all of his friends, and one of them mutters out loud, "This guy eats with tax collectors and sinners." And what he's reflecting is, we would never do something like that. We would not sully our names by associating with the riffraff of our country. Well, Jesus, John says Jesus is like no other person. He knows the hearts of all men, is what John says. He knows exactly what that guy's saying. So I picture him looking over at the Pharisee and his crowd, who are now back to their skeptical, cynical ways, and looking across the table at the tax collector. He knows that guy's heart, and he knows this guy's heart. And you think about this guy's heart, the tax collector's heart. Do you know about tax collectors? Tax collectors in that day were Jewish citizens who had sold out to the Romans. They'd said, "You need taxes collected? I'll collect them. I'll take money from my people and give it to you." How do you think the rest of the Jews felt about their tax collector brothers? Not very good. I mean, the Pharisee had it right. He's eating with a tax collector. I picture Jesus looking that guy in the eye and knowing all about him. He knows his wife. He knows how she's feeling, how shaky their situation is, as everybody in town hates him. Probably knows about their kids. Probably knows this guy's heart. Think for a second. What would it take? I mean, how desperate would you have to be to take a job like that? So when the Pharisee says, "This man is a friend of sinners," you know what Jesus does? He turns to him and he says, "Guilty as charged. Guilty as charged. You think that I'm a friend of sinners, and I am. I am. I am." That's the story that takes place in Luke chapter 15, and I want to invite you to turn there with me this morning as we continue our series in the book of Luke called "He Was Perfect." Guilty as charged. I am exactly that. Luke 15, I got to tell you, it's my favorite passage in the entire Bible. With a fit of eloquence and grace, Jesus tells these Pharisees and everybody else who's listening why and how much he loves sinners. He tells them not one, not two, but three stories, back to back to back, about who matters to him and why he came to earth. It's as if he's saying, "People accuse me of loving unloving people, and I do. I really do. I really, really do. And just so it's clear, just so you'll never again wonder who matters to me and who doesn't, I'm going to tell you why. I'm going to tell you all about it. I'm going to tell you right here and right now. Of all the Bible stories about God's purposes in this world, in my humble opinion, these three stories in Luke 15 provide the most clarity about what matters to God and what doesn't in all of Scripture. So, if you will, listen carefully this morning as we unpack God's Word. He has something to say to us about Himself, something to say to us about us, and something to say to us about our neighbors. Fair enough? So if you haven't already done it, open a Bible to Luke 15. If you take one of our Bibles under the chair, it's on page 928. And as we're getting ready, if you're ready to do some learning with me, pray this out loud. Going to throw you a curveball this morning. Pray this. Lord Jesus, I want to hear from you today. Speak to me now. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen, and in your mind, picture what's going on as we read Luke 15. Verse 1. All the tax collectors and sinners were approaching to listen to him, and the Pharisees and scribes were complaining, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. What man among you who has 100 sheep and loses one of them does not leave the 99 in the open field and go after the lost one until he finds it? When he's found it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders, and coming home, he calls his friends and neighbors together, saying, "Rejoice with me, because I found my lost sheep." I tell you, Jesus says, in the same way, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who don't need repentance. This is why we applaud when someone raises their hand to say, "I invited Jesus into my life today." All of heaven throws a party, and we should too. Verse 8, or what woman who has 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together, saying, "Rejoice with me, because I found the silver coin I lost." Jesus says, "I tell you, in the same way, there's joy in the presence of God's angels over one sinner who repents." Can I say it again? This is why when someone says, "I became a Christian today," we all rejoice, because all heaven rejoices. There's this party in heaven. I call it the party popper moment. I don't know if they have those little things in heaven, but you know what I'm talking about. You know, you pull the end of it and it goes chink, and it's kind of cool. I don't think they drink champagne. They could. I don't know. But they got to do something because they're celebrating, right? So we celebrate because they celebrate. Here's the third story. Verse 11. He also said a man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate I have coming to me." So he distributed the assets to them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered together all he had and traveled to a distant country where he squandered his estate in foolish living. Parenthetically, before Social Security, children were expected to care for their parents in their old age, not vice versa. So this kid should have expected to take care of his parents, not run off with their money. This would have been considered elder abuse in that day. This son has no control. He's a self-centered rebel. Jesus said after he had spent everything, a severe famine struck that country, and he had nothing. Then he went to work for one of the citizens of that country who sent him into the fields to feed pigs. This is the low point in the story. Jews aren't allowed to feed pigs. They're not allowed to be around pigs. If they touch a pig, they're considered unclean for the next 6 weeks and can't come in contact with anybody around them. Verse 16, he longed to eat his fill from the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one would give him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired workers have more than enough food? And here I am dying of hunger. I'm going to get up, go to my father, and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired workers.'" So that's what he did. He got up and he went to his father. But while the son was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran, threw his arms around his neck, and kissed him. The son said, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and again, and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father told his servants, "Quick, bring out the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Then bring the fattened calf and slaughter it, and let's celebrate with a feast. Because this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." So they began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he summoned one of the servants, questioning what these things meant. "Your brother is here," he told him, "and your father has slaughtered the fattened calf because he has him back home safe and sound." Then this older brother became angry and did not want to go in. So his father came out and pleaded with him, but he replied to his father, "Look, all of this time I've been slaving for you. I never once disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me so much as a goat so that I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours comes home, who's devoured your assets with prostitutes, you slaughter the fattened calf for him." "Son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." I love those words. We had to celebrate. We had to celebrate. These are three amazing stories, wouldn't you agree? These are the stories that, when I finally figured them out 33 years ago, reshaped my life. And I'm hoping that maybe for some of you, they'll reshape your life this morning. Reading these stories, I decided that the only honest response to them was for me to fall in line behind Jesus and participate as fully as I could in reaching and saving what he calls lost people. Along with his sweat blood prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane and his cries of agony on the cross, I believe these three stories are Jesus' most vulnerable moments on earth. Again, for context, he's come miles south. He's getting close to the cross. He knows what's coming. He came for this reason. This is not going to be an accident. He knows there's going to be beating and blood and humiliation, and the Father's going to lay the sin of the world on him on our behalf. These things are constantly on his mind. Jesus is fully God and fully man. So when these religious leaders accuse him of being a friend of tax collectors and sinners, as if it's a crime, he says, "You're right, I'm guilty. I do love sinners, because God loves sinners. And oh, how I wish you would love sinners too." I want to walk through, with the time that's remaining, these three little stories. They are powerful stories. And if you catch them, they just might change your whole perception of God, yourself, and the world around you. Can we do that together? So in these stories, kind of baseline, in every one of them, something winds up missing. Can you see that? The shepherd loses a sheep, the woman loses a coin, and the father loses a son. And doesn't it seem like what's missing really matters? Really, deeply matters to the one who loses it. I mean, the shepherd is so concerned with his one little lamb. Jesus says he actually leaves the 99 out in the open field just to go find this one. And the woman is so concerned that she lights a lamp and scours the house to find her coin. And the father so longs for his son to come back that he's constantly scanning the horizon, hoping to see that boy come over it unscathed. And what happens in each of these stories? What happens when that which was lost gets found? Did you notice? There's a party in every single one of them. The shepherd comes to the middle of the village and crows, "Rejoice with me, because I found my lost sheep." It was probably the middle of the night when he did that. What's up with that? Why did he do that? Well, I don't know for sure, and let's be clear. Jesus made up these stories to make a point, so there isn't really a backstory, but here's how I picture the backstory of the lost sheep and his shepherd. Can I give it to you? So the 99 come home with him. He knows them all by name. He numbers them and calls them by name. And just before he closes the pen, he realizes Fluffy's not there. Yeah, maybe that's not his name. Probably a Hebrew name for Fluffy, right? So I think he drops everything and he goes to his wife and says, "Don't wait dinner. I got to go find Fluffy. I might not be back for a long time." And his wife, she's so concerned about him, she probably goes to the next door neighbor and says, "Hey, would you pray with me?" So that probably happens all over the village, you know. Whatever his name is, George, is out looking for Fluffy. And Doris is spreading the news in the neighborhood. Again, not their names, but go with me, dramatic license. So when the shepherd gets home with Fluffy on his shoulders, the whole village is waiting up. On his way past Fred's house, Fred sticks his nose out the window and said, "Did you find the lamb?" "I did. Here he is." Fred says, "Wow, really cool." Then he passes Clark's house, and the same thing happens. And then John and Bill and Al, and by the time he gets to the square, almost to his house, he realizes everybody's been waiting. So he just shouts out, "Everybody, everybody, here's Fluffy. I found him. Rejoice with me." Again, I don't know if that's the backstory, but it kind of fits, doesn't it? You can give me credit for that if you write the book. Then there comes the coin lady. Let's call her Margaret. When Margaret finds her coin, what does she do? It says she calls all her friends to her house. Now, you know some stuff about Middle Eastern hospitality. What happens when you call people over to your house? You got to feed them. So maybe Margaret's lost coin is worth 50 or maybe 100 bucks. How much do you think it costs her to feed all of those people? Probably more than the coin. This is irrational. She has an irrational positive attachment to this coin that exceeds monetary value. Can you see that? And then there's the father. And we got to call him by that name because clearly he is the father. He is so well described that it's got to be the heavenly father, don't you think? Did you catch what kind of party the father threw when the son came home? I mean, this is just a vivid picture. One of the greatest parties ever experienced, probably, in whatever that fictitious village was. Before heading to the party, Jesus says the father kissed the son, which, you know, we're Americans, we go, "Well, that's a little awkward. Hope he did it like on his neck and real quick and all that." I mean, that's just weird. Not to a Middle Easterner. Or think about a French guy. The Greek word, the original language word for this is not like he just kissed him, like, "Man, good to see you. Glad we got that over with." This father, in the original Greek, it says he kissed him over and over and over and over and over again. Ran to him, threw his arms around him. It's a great picture. And then he says to his servant, "Quick, go get the best robe. Put it on him." This is a Middle Eastern home. Who has the best robe in the family? Dad does. "Put my robe on him." Says, "Bring the ring." We believe the ring would be the signet ring. In well-to-do families, they didn't just sign stuff. They sealed them with a ring that had their signature on it. This is our family. This guy is fully restored, is what he's saying. And then put sandals on his feet. You know why? In Middle Eastern culture back then, slaves went barefoot. Sons wore shoes. He's restoring him to full sonship. And then there's the animal. What kind of animal does he kill? The fatted calf. Not the fatted chicken. Not the fatted goat or the fatted pheasant. This is a big party. We're killing the biggest thing in the barnyard. We're going to feast together. He says, "We had to celebrate. We had to celebrate. We had to celebrate." This is the biggest thing that's happened in his entire life. His son came home. I was a Christian for a lot of years before I read this story the way I just told it to you now. Because quite often Christians, including me, when we open the Bible, we read a story and go, "That's a good story." And then we close the Bible and pray a couple minutes and move on. And there's three stories in this chapter. But can you see that there's not really three stories? So 33 years ago, I read all three of them back to back to back. And God hit me with what I want to show you, which is where your message notes start this morning, that there's really just one story that's kind of amplified, reinforcing the point Jesus is making over and over and over again. I am guilty. I do love lost people. Here's the first point he's making. Lost people matter to him. Can you see that? The sheep mattered to the shepherd. The coin mattered to the woman. The son really mattered to the father. When I first saw this, I didn't really care about people who were outside of a relationship with Jesus. I was on staff at a church as an associate pastor. My job was to love the members of my church. So I remember reading this kind of academically going, oh, that's interesting. But you can't miss the implication. Lost people matter to God, and therefore, they ought to matter to me. They ought to matter to us. Can you see that? That's what Jesus is saying in this passage. If the 99 sheep were left in the open field to go find the lost one really matters, and therefore he, she ought to matter to us. I read this passage and said, wow, maybe I ought to care for lost people too. Maybe I ought to pray for them. Maybe I ought to hang out with them. And after a couple weeks of living with this truth, the Holy Spirit whispered to me, Hal, if you really want to participate with me in reaching lost people, you should start a church dedicated to that. This is the passage that caused me to leave Longmont, Colorado to move here 33 years ago, and my life has never been the same since. Lost people matter to God, and therefore they ought to matter to us. Let's go a little farther with that. Can you see that in all of these stories, God is on an all-out search to retrieve what is lost? I mean, you know, let's review. Once the shepherd counted his sheep that night and realized Fluffy was missing, he didn't let anything keep him from finding Fluffy. And while he was looking, he wasn't distracted by the flowers on the path or the dangerous predators in front of him or the rocks or the cliffs or the empty stomach. He was just thinking, find Fluffy, find Fluffy, find Fluffy, find Fluffy. You see that? And the third thing I think you can't miss in this is that all heaven rejoices when one lost person comes home. Jesus says it not once but twice. In verse 7, he says, I tell you in the same way, there's more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents. And a sinner is simply you and I. We're people who are not perfect. Anybody in here perfect? Okay, I mean, it's not a derogatory term. It just means someone who missed the mark. It's an archery term. All heaven rejoices over one sinner who repents more than over 99 righteous people who don't need repentance. Verse 10 says the same thing. I tell you, in the same way, there is joy in the presence of the angels in heaven over one sinner who repents. God is saying it here. Heaven throws a party every time one sinner comes to the Savior. Wow. Pretty cool. Have you come to the Savior? There's been a party for you. I don't know if they have a marker in heaven or not, but it happened for you. In the first service, a gal sitting right over there gave her life to Jesus, and we all rejoiced. Because that's what happens in heaven. We might as well reflect it on earth. All heaven rejoices when one person says, God, I need you, and invites him into their lives. Why would God do that? What compels him to be moved by that sort of thing? You want to know what I think? I think God can't help himself. I think God so loves us that he created us to have a relationship with him. And when we reconnect, we walked away, he didn't. When we reconnect, he goes, wow. That's why I sent my son. That's why I created the entire universe. See, the thing is, God doesn't have love. The Bible says God is love. All of his being is love. He has to love because that's who he is. So if we're out of relationship with him, he doesn't like that at all. He can't love us if we turn our backs on him. He loves us so much that he wants us in his life and he wants to be in our lives. God so loved the world. Last Saturday, right in this room, we invited the Billy Graham Association to do a training. Franklin Graham's going to come to Chula Vista in a couple months, March 9th, if you're interested. And he's going to do a semi-traditional Billy Graham crusade, if you've ever seen one of those. So a bunch of us gathered in here to get trained so we could be counselors for when someone said, I want to become a Christian. And Franklin does it a little different than Billy. If you've seen, you all know that Billy's not with us anymore, right? Billy used to have people come down front. We were trained. Franklin has them stand up right where they are. So he's going to lead them in a prayer and then say, if you prayed the prayer, stand up. And we were trained, then if you're near somebody who stood up, you do three things. Number one, you walk over to them and say, hi, my name is Hal, or you wouldn't use that name, but what's your name? And then you say, can I ask why you stood up? And if they say, well, Franklin told me if I prayed the prayer, I should stand up, and I prayed the prayer, then you say, wonderful, let me pray for you. But if they don't know why, then the third thing you say is, well, can I share with you how to have peace with God? And Billy, long, long ago, boiled kind of the whole gospel down to four steps. They handed us a brochure and said, here's what we want you to do for the next 5 minutes. Pair off and practice that. And all of you say, no, I don't know why I stood up. So the person can say, well, can I tell you then how to have peace with God? So that we could all practice the steps. Can I tell you Billy's four steps to peace with God? Yeah. Here they are. I think we've got a slide for that. Step one is, God has a purpose. God loves you and wants you to experience peace and eternal life. Did you know that? That's critical to all of life, to understanding why you're here. And then the second step is to understand the problem. See, the problem is that God created us in His image. He gave us a will and freedom of choice just like He has. And we chose to disobey Him and go our own way, which puts separation between us and God. Can you see that? God's perfect. We're not. So God's solution to that is a bridge that He built. Step three, Jesus died on the cross and rose from the grave. He paid the penalty for our sin and bridged the gap between us and God. That's the solution. So then the application, what you do if you want a relationship with God, is our response. Step four, we must trust and receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. So all over the room, we're having these little conversations, and the Billy Graham guys are coming by saying, how's it going, and all that. And as I'm looking around, I'm thinking, wow, this is so cool. There are like 50 of us going to go down there. And we're all going to have an opportunity. They said, you know, you may have 2 or 3 or 5 or 10 people around you with no other prayer counselor. We need thousands of these prayer counselors, they said. So just, you know, gather people up. If there's more than one, don't let them go. And I'm thinking, wow, wouldn't that be cool if all 50 of us in this room had a chance to lead someone to Christ? I mean, that would just be wonderful, wouldn't it? But then I went farther and thought, what if every new songer in this next, I don't know, 6 months, year or two, had an opportunity to lead someone to Christ? I mean, that would just light our church on fire, wouldn't it? So, announcing a new dream here, my hope, and I've started praying about it, is that every single one of us sometime in the next year or two would have a chance to invite someone into relationship with Jesus Christ. They would respond to become Christians. That includes you. Fair enough? Praying for you. Because I know it changed my life. A few weeks after I became a Christian, I had barely started reading the Bible. I'd never opened one before the night I became a Christian. So I didn't really know much. I didn't know Billy Graham had four steps that I could explain to people and all that. So what I did with my friend Dave, we were both swimmers, I did with Dave what happened to me. I had gone with my swim team coach to a coffee house meeting that explained the gospel and sang songs, kind of like a church service. I didn't grow up in a church like that, so I didn't know it was like a church service. But at the end, on the way home, my swim team coach asked if I'd like to receive Christ, and I did. And everything changed for me. So when my friends to do that, and I thought, I don't know how to do that, but what if I invite Dave to go with us, and what if the coach on the way home led him to Christ? So during the whole service, I'm watching Dave to make sure he's feeling comfortable and he's okay with his setting and all that, and then I made sure he got to sit in the front seat with the coach on the way back. I'm sitting in the back seat, and I'm just praying my knuckles raw that the coach is going to ask him the same questions he asked me and that Dave's going to give the same answers. And he did, and he did. And I watched as Dave Smith gave his life to Christ. He was bawling. I mean, it was like the car lit up. I watched eternity enter Dave's life. I watched the weight of sin raised off of his back. And we're only 14 years old. You know, how much sin can you have at that age? Actually, you can have a good amount, can't you? But Dave got, I got forgiven, then Dave got forgiven, and it changed me. On that very first time, it changed me. And I want all of you to experience that too. At the end of the first service during the discussion time, there was a little gal sitting with me and her grandparents over here. And she said, I don't know how to start a conversation like that. So I said, well, here's a way. You just say, you have any spiritual background? She said, oh, I could do that. And I said, or an even easier way, you could just say, hey, you want to go to church with me next week? She said, oh, I could do that. And that's pretty much what I did. I invited Dave to this coffee house meeting. I couldn't explain the gospel. I knew what had happened to me, but I was pretty new, and the coach did it. You bring a friend next week, I'll do it for you, okay? You're sitting next to somebody who you brought, you're going to feel great about the whole thing, don't you think? And there are 52 great opportunities to invite a friend. If you're a friend here this morning, I'm so glad that you came, and I hope in a couple minutes I'm going to offer you the opportunity to have your life changed by Jesus Christ. Hope you'll say yes to that. It's kind of a no-brainer. It's all for you, all from Him. But next week is an especially opportune time because Willie Buchanan's going to be here. By 8 o'clock tonight, all of us will know who the two teams are in the Super Bowl. And then the buzz will start. Everybody will start talking about it. And all the news for the next 2 weeks will be about this is their wide receiver and this is their left tackle and this is their quarterback and here's what's likely to happen. In America, we call it the Super Bowl because we kind of worship the thing. It's a big deal, wouldn't you agree? And this is the only week during the football season where there's a break between weeks. So next Sunday, the break between weeks, we're bringing in a local guy who in his rookie season won the Super Bowl, and we're going to say, hey, Willie, tell us what's that like? So that this week you can say to a friend, hey, you want to come see a Super Bowl champion? He's going to come to our church, and the pastor's going to ask him to tell us what they're all going through as they have one more week to prepare for this thing. And then Willie's got four principles he's going to share with us. And then I'll invite anybody in the room to receive Jesus. It's a pretty simple thing, wouldn't you agree? And look, you know, in the first service, we only had 15 open seats. In your service, we got a lot of them. But wouldn't it be cool if we had to set up extra chairs because every single one of us brought a friend next week? Well, it's not really even about bringing a friend, right? It's about them hearing that God loves them. Fair enough? So maybe I should go there. Here's what Jesus is saying in this passage. God loves you. Or the way I put it was people matter to God. Therefore, they ought to matter to us as well. Because all of us were lost at one time. And what I said to the first service, I want to say to you as well. If you're here today or if you're watching online thinking, well, there goes that Christian guy with his exclusive superior attitude, please understand me. I don't think I'm superior to anybody, and I think nobody in this room thinks that. We are all sinners in need of a Savior. We would all admit that we've done wrong. This place is not a museum for saints. It's a hospital for sinners. We're here because we need God. We think we've found something that'll fill your soul. It's like one beggar finding bread telling another beggar, it's over here. Come get some. That's our whole deal. We found the source of life, and we would like you to have it too because God has done so much for us. Fair enough? So all people matter to God, and in Jesus' stories, when you think about it, the coin plays a very passive part in getting lost, right? I mean, somehow it fell out of probably the lady's box and rolled under a couch or something. The sheep played a more active part in getting lost. He willfully walked away from the shepherd because he's distracted by, you know, little tidbits of green here and there. And hey, who can blame, you know, what's a sheep's IQ? Probably 15. Who can blame it for wandering off, right? And then there's the son. Jesus is illustrating different levels of deliberateness of moving away. The son deliberately moved away. The son at one point wanted nothing to do with the father. So he went to the far, far country like Shrek did. Stick with content. What Jesus is saying is, doesn't matter what or why you moved away. If you're away, I want you to come back. God's arms are open wide for you. He wants to kiss you all over and put his robe on your back and his ring on your finger. And then there's this lost piece that sometimes trips people up. Lost. It really is a non-judgmental description. The coin got lost. The sheep got lost. The boy was lost. You know, I'll tell you, I'm really good at getting lost. When the GPS was invented, I bought one. Long before they put it on my watch or my phone. I mean, I can tell you how to get up there, but getting around here, I have been lost in Chicago. I've been lost in Dublin, Ireland. I've been lost on mountains more than once. I've been lost in parking lots because I forgot where I parked my car. I'm good at getting lost. And you know, lost is interesting, isn't it? Have you ever been lost? You don't know you're lost, right? You're just wandering around till it dawns on you, I'm lost. And then you feel, oh no, I'm lost. Nobody wants to feel that feeling, right? God doesn't want you to feel that feeling, so he says, I came for you. I know exactly where you are. I know exactly how to get you home. Come home with me. Jesus' final words on the supper time when he was with the fellows before he went to the cross were, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. I'm the way. If you're lost, I can get you there. I'm the way. I'm the way. I am your way. So one point in this story is we have an incredible God who loves us very much. Another point is he's called us into relationship. And whosoever will may come. No matter what caused you to get lost. Do you see that? So in just a second, I want to invite you, if you're here or online, to let God find you. Only it really depends on you. The most apt analogy in these three is the third one, the son, because he had a choice. He decided, you know, how many of my father's hired hands have food? If I come home, the Father's going to feed me. And the Father does. If you'd like Jesus, if you'd like God, if you'd like the forgiveness of God and a permanent relationship with him, that's what he has longed for. And you can have that starting 30 seconds from now if you'll just invite him in. That's what he has waited for. That's why Jesus came. So I'm going to ask you all to bow your heads, and then I'm going to ask anyone in the room who wants Jesus. If you've never invited him into your life, you must do this. He will not force his way in. You must invite him. So if you want the forgiveness of God and a relationship with him and the power of the Holy Spirit in your life and direction and help forever, these are all his promises. If you want that, then just under your breath, I want you to pray it out loud so that you know you've prayed it. You didn't just think it in your mind and you later on go, oh, did I really do this? I want you to say it out loud, but you don't have to say it loud enough even for the next neighbor next to you to know. Just whisper, Lord, whisper these words, Lord Jesus, come into my life. Lord Jesus, I want you to forgive my sins, the things I've done wrong, and I want you to be my Lord, my leader from now on. I give you my life and purpose to follow you with the rest of it. And then just say, in Jesus' name, amen. And if you prayed that prayer, you know what's going on in heaven right now? Partay. Yeah. If you prayed that prayer, I just want to say welcome to the family of God. Would you raise your hand like the lady did in the first service? Just wave your hand at me so I can say welcome to the family, and we're glad that the party poppers are going on for you. I know. Your hand weighs 50 pounds right now. Welcome to the family of God. This is a big day for you. It's a big day for all of us because salvation has come to this house. Anybody else, how's this side of the room doing? I got a waving hand. And there's always somebody, you know, I'd love new lights someday so there's not dark. If there's someone here waving your hand, would you wave it so I can see it? I just want to look in the eye and say, welcome to the family. We're rejoicing, but we don't know who it is. Oh, it's back here? Really in the dark. Somebody here, is that you? Welcome to the family of God. So at the risk of going overtime, I just want to tell both of you, this is something amazing happened in your life. The Holy Spirit entered you. You're going to wake up tomorrow morning and go, I have purpose. God is with me. My soul is lighter because I've been forgiven. Isn't that true? You're going to feel that way. Every one of us who've ever experienced this, and you want to respond to that. You want to talk to God. You want to get a Bible. We'll give you one on the way out and start reading in the New Testament. Maybe Luke. Luke is a great place to look. That's where we're looking these days. But this is your day. Mark it. It's called your spiritual birthday, January 28th, 2024. And we are all exceedingly happy, almost as happy as the angels, aren't we? So with my profound ending, I will say again, that's all I got. God bless you all. Welcome Scott up here.
So we are going to have our time of discussion. And what I love about the discussion time is it actually makes this, you have to participate in this. And I just love that. You know, we participate in singing and we just heard from God, but now we get to participate and be a family together talking about these two questions that'll pop up on the screen. The two questions are, what did you like about the stories Jesus told? And which of the message's three points means the most to you and why? And so what I'd encourage you to do is meet somebody around you and then just kind of process these questions. Remember, here we're not a building, we're a family, so meet somebody new. I'll give you 3 minutes to talk about these two questions. Go. All righty, let's come back together, wrap up your discussion. During one of the discussions that I got to have was with a Marine and talk about how each one of these different stories really show you hope. There's hope for any and all of us, and that we have a God that comes after. It was a really profound discussion that me and a Marine had, especially for that guy who's, you know, he's around a lot of lost people at Camp Pendleton, so that's why we do these discussions, to help me and him process through this kind of stuff. So now we're going to do something a little different. We're going to move into a more responding, and so one of those points was that lost people matter to God, and therefore they ought to matter to me. And so maybe you want to pray for somebody lost that's in your life that you know, and maybe somebody that you want to invite to the Willie Buchanan Sunday next week. So we'll have prayer partners up here who would love to pray with you about that or whatever is going on in your life. So take advantage of the prayer partners that are up here. We'll also be singing one final song. The offering bags will be coming by. After they come by, then you feel free to stand up. And I just love that point that lost people matter to him, therefore they ought to matter to me. I just can't get over that point because that's what we are all about here at New Song. And that's why when you give, it goes to that. It's loving the lost people and making them matter to us and to God. Let me pray for this time. God, we thank you that we do matter to you. All of us do, God. And that is so profound when we think about that. I pray that that truth would bury deep into our hearts about how much you love us, but also how much you care about the lost people that are in our lives. I pray that you would help us to want to love those lost people as much as you love them, God. Give us the courage and the boldness to invite those you want us to invite, God. And give us the boldness and encouragement to do what next steps you've been putting on our hearts, God. And I would pray that you would bless this offering and bless those who give. It is in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
I want to invite you all to stand and worship with us.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven, spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished. The end is written, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace?
came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no name.
So we have 46 high schoolers up at Big Bear. Pastor Mike took them up there to help them grow in Christ. He said, I don't think we're going to take in any kids who don't know Jesus. Well, four kids came to know Jesus on Friday night, and one more came to Jesus last night. So I think tremendous things are happening with them up there. And the other good news, I saved the best part of the stories for last. When the prodigal son decides to come home, he rehearses a speech all the way home. He says, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. When he gets home, he can't say that last phrase. He says, Father, I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. And he stops. He can't finish it. You know why? Because the Bible says the father ran to him, threw his arms around him, and as I said, smothered him with kisses. So this boy, all the way home, maybe this is you, all the way home, pictured himself falling at the father's feet and kissing his feet in humiliation. He can't do it. The father loves him too much to let him do that. Instead of getting greeted with feet, he gets greeted with open arms. And I wanted to tell you that right at the end, because I know sometimes some of us wake up in the morning, we go, I don't know if life is worth living, or this is a struggle I'm going to have to get through today. No, it's not! Wake up and let God throw his arms around you. He's been waiting to see you, waiting to do life with you. He will walk with you. He's crazy about you. Live every week, and this week, live every day like that, and I think it'll be better. Amen? Amen. Very good. Invite a friend to Willie, and see you next week. God bless you all.